Good morning. Welcome to worship with Willow Avenue Mennonite Church. If we haven't met before, I'm Audrey Hines, senior pastor here at Willow Avenue, where Jesus welcomes all, and so do we. Whether you are with us online or here in person, we are so glad to be able to be together this morning. Today is the fourth Sunday in the season of Epiphany, the season of light. And we're very excited to have with us this morning our guest preacher, Katarina Heya. Everybody has wondered how to pronounce her last name. It's Heya. Okay, now we've all got it. Katarina is the organizer of the Repair Network of congregations and communities who have joined the coalition to dismantle the doctrine of discovery as a way of growing in education and solidarity alongside Indigenous communities. Katarina is also the pastor of Wild Church, one of our sister congregations in the Pacific Southwest Mennonite Conference here in Fresno. Thank you, Katarina, for your prayerful preparation for your sermon this morning and for sharing with us in adult ed later today. And also welcome to Stefan Guizar. You're doing special music today, and I understand it's one of your own compositions. So thank you for sharing that gift with us this morning. We look forward to being blessed by your music. We invite you all to text any prayer requests or concerns to 559-960-5956 for Pastor Arthur to lift up during our prayers for the church, community, and world a little bit later in our service. And now let us take a moment in silence to prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Invite you to stand in body or spirit for our opening hymn, God of Grace and God of Glory, in Voices Together 716.
Grant us wisdom, grant us grace. Please be seated.
Welcome the children to come up for a moment. Good morning, Leah. Good morning, Micah. Leah, you've got some fancy new specs on. Are they real? No. I'm curious because I'm getting some that are supposed to come tomorrow. So I thought maybe we would be like sisters in new specs or something. Well, that's not what I want to talk about. Do you like to share? Is that something that's fun? Do you enjoy sharing? Yeah, Micah. So do you ever feel worried when you need to share? You don't think so? That's great. I'm gonna tell you a secret. So adults love to teach children about sharing. It's like one of our favorite things, to teach you how important it is to share. But the truth is, sometimes we get really anxious about sharing. Sometimes we get worried or scared about sharing. You wanna know why? Because we're worried that if we share what we have with somebody else, then we won't have enough. True story. Now, there's no godly play today. So you get to stay in here with us for the whole service. And I bet you that one of the words that we're gonna hear maybe more than once is the word justice. Have you heard this word before? Do you know what it means? Everyone's equal. What? Has somebody been teaching this child? That's beautiful. So I'm going to tell you something else. A lot of us think that justice means getting back at someone when they do something to us, but that's not God's way of justice. God's way of justice involves sharing sometimes. One way to think about it is sharing. So we're going to listen to a song by a guy named Jack Johnson. He has this song about sharing, and he has some creative ideas about sharing. So we're going to have the words up on the screen, and y'all are welcome to sing along if you feel so inclined. And we're going to come sit here and we can sing it together too, okay? Okay.
It's always more fun to share with everyone. It's always more fun to share with everyone. If you have to give one to your friend, if you have three, give one to your friend and me. It's always more fun to share with everyone. It's always more fun to share with everyone. If you have one, here is something you can learn. Still share just by taking turns. If you've got a ball, bounce it to the gang. If there is a new kid, invite him out to hang. If you've got one sandwich, cut that thing in half. If you know a secret joke, tell it and share a laugh. One drumstick, give one to your friend. Make one beautiful rhythm, share a beat that never ends. And if you're feeling lonely, share time with your mom. Share some milk and cookies and sing the sharing song.
Everybody,
it's always more fun to share with everyone. It's always more fun. It's always more fun.
with everyone.
Yes, it is.
It's always more fun to share with everyone.
Share a beat now.
That's where it gets really groovy, but I'll go ahead. I know, it's the best part. So I wonder if you got any ideas about sharing from that song. No, any new ideas? Not really, you already knew it all, I know. The thing that I love about that part, how do you share if there's only one of something? Trade, he says, if you have one sandwich, you could cut it in half. If you have only one ball, you could take turns. There's lots of ways to share. It's pretty cool. So we are going to think about justice and think about sharing today. And I'm so glad that you already know what justice means. I think that means there's hope for us. We're so glad that you're here, and remember that God loves you and that we love you too, okay? And we're so glad that the rest of you are here too.
As we move to a time of praying together for our church, community, and world, I just remind you, if there's anything you would like for us to pray, I'm going to get my phone. So while I'm going to get my phone, if there's anything you would like for us to pray or know about together, the number that you could send that to is 559-290-5906. So I'll give you a second to think about that while I go get my phone. Okay, let's try that again. I did want us to begin this morning, each wherever we are, whether we're on Zoom or Facebook or here in person, to take just a moment to kind of collect our thoughts. So if you want to, you can close your eyes. You don't have to do that for this, but some people find it helpful, just to kind of center ourselves. Maybe just think this morning about where you are physically. And think about how you are feeling this morning, physically, emotionally. Where are you this morning? And we're aware this morning that we each come and are in different places, and yet we join together in this time of prayer. We're thankful, God, that we're able to be with you wherever we are, and you with us. The other thing I'd like to invite you to do this morning, quietly on your own, is to think of maybe one thing that you are thankful for this morning. Could be a conversation that you've had this past week, something that's taken place in your own life, something that you're aware of. What is something that you're thankful for this morning? And then I invite you, just in the quiet space where you are this morning, to offer that as a praise to God, in whichever words you want to use, or if you don't want to use words, but just to think about that thing. How is that a praise this morning? And then as we turn our attention to things that are on our hearts and minds this morning, and we're aware of things in our own lives, in our world, in our community, and in relationships, it's So I'm going to walk us through praying for some of the things that I'm aware of and that people have sent in. I'll also make a moment if you want to voice out anything as well. I will say whichever thing it is and end that by saying, Lord, in your mercy. And you can join in this prayer by saying, hear our prayer. It's a way for us to pray together for the things that I will be voicing from the front. This morning, Lord, we're aware of so much violence in our world. We're mindful of a number of shootings across our country, across our city. And we pray for your peace. We pray for your justice. We pray for us to be involved in the work of your reconciling kingdom. I think this morning, God, of the city of Memphis, one family, but one of many families affected by violence and brutality, unchecked use of power and violence. Pray for comfort for those who are mourning. And we pray for your ways to come. Lord, just for the places in our country where there's been violence this week, we pray, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, be mindful of ongoing war in Ukraine, unrest in Peru, violence in the Congo, conflict in Palestine and Israel. And if you want to name any other places that are on your hearts this morning, Lord, for all these places where there is conflict and enmity between people, for whatever the reasons, God, for those who get caught up in this violence, those who are affected by it, those who are displaced, harmed, killed, for those who are left mourning, for those who are left alone, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. That we're mindful this morning of our neighbors around us. I think particularly this morning of the residents at Butterfly Gardens. God, thank you that they're able to have new housing, new services, and new opportunities for healthy and whole lives. Thank you for the leadership of that community, and thank you for the ways that we're able to work with them. And God, show us more ways that we can be a blessing to our neighbors at Butterfly Gardens this morning. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, I'm mindful of many in our own community who are not well today, some of which I'm aware of and some not. This morning we pray for Gary Barber recovering from COVID and beginning infusion treatment this Wednesday. And we pray healing and strength and peace for Gary. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. This Morning, we pray for Charlie De Palma, who is home with a cold this morning. Pray healing for her. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, this morning we pray for Mark and Grace with COVID. Pray for your healing hand on them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For Kaylee Ortman, youth pastor at First Mennonite Church in Reedley and chaplain at Sierra View Retirement Community, and we pray for him as he's been experiencing general weakness, particularly in his hands. And we pray for the doctors as he's trying to figure out what's going on and for them to make diagnoses. Pray encouragement for Kaylee today. Pray for your presence and your strength for him. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for Ernst and Karen this morning. Strength and healing for them. God, would you draw close to them and lift their spirits this morning? Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Pray for continued healing for Olivia's granddaughter, Reagan. Pray strength for her. Pray for her family. God, would you provide all the things that they need? Would you be the lifter of her head today? Help us, God, as we want to continue ministering and remembering her and them. This morning, God, we pray especially for Reagan. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. This morning we pray for Lily and Marvin Croker. God, we thank you for them and the gift that they are to our community. Bless them today. I pray particularly for Lily and her strength. God, remind them today of your great love for them. We're thankful for them. And so we pray for Marvin and for Lily. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Now this morning we're mindful of Fresno Pacific University, the time of challenge and transition that they're facing. We pray for all of those who are involved in finding the best ways to serve students and to serve you. Pray for wisdom, pray for strength, guidance, and provision. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, this morning we pray for the Vinery team from our congregation as they travel to South Carolina for the opening gathering of their cohort. We pray for safe travels and encouragement in this new project. We pray for your wisdom and new ideas and how our congregation connect with the communities, particularly at Fresno State University. God, we ask your blessing on this new project as we dive in. May it bring life and light, both to us and to those we will work with in our community. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. I just pause as well. If there's other things for those of you who are praying with us now that you want to say aloud or say quietly in your heart and mind, to offer up as a prayer. Thank you for Dolores' Uncle Simon. We pray too for Stan and Dolores as they travel to Goshen to celebrate with him. So for this Uncle Simon, God, this morning, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, thank you for the many things on our hearts and minds, spoken and unspoken. God, thank you that you hear these things. Thank you that you open our hearts to what is on your heart. Continue to, God, to show us how we can partner with you in bringing your love to our world, to our community, to our neighbors, to our families, and to one another. Thank you, God. We give all these prayers to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen.
As much as I adore singing songs of praises, love and adoration to our Creator, I think sometimes we avoid in music the realities of our faith, which often consist of doubt and uncertainty, and a lot of my music is geared towards that. Somebody pray, somebody pray for me. Won't somebody say the right things to get me to tomorrow? Must I believe to be saved? Must I be certain to see your holy face? Must I speak to deserve your mercy? To deserve your mercy? To deserve mercy? Still I believe in the kingdom come, when all the colors they will bleed into one, they will bleed into one. But yes, I'm still running. You broke the bond.
Thank you, Stefan. Appreciate it. He is a seminary student at Fresno Pacific and engaged in music ministry. I invite you now to turn your attention to the prophet Micah, We'll be reading chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. It's a legal case which the Lord invites witnesses, presents the case, and then calls for our response. Micah chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. Hear what the Lord says. Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the case of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a case against his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? In what have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt, redeemed you from the house of slavery, and I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember now what King Balak of Moab devised, what Balaam, son of Beor, answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the saving acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rivers of oil, with thousands of rams? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? May we find wisdom in these ancient words.
What does the Lord require of you? It's not necessarily what God asked of Abraham. It can simply be to come to the mountain of God. That's the title of this next song. Would you all stand? And please remain standing during the reading of the gospel. But this next song was written by Phil Campbell Innes. He's the pastor of Home Street Mennonites in Manitoba. And this is his vision of what the mountain of God is.
Let us go to a place that is pure, to learn. The gospel reading today is one in which a tax collector has an interesting encounter with Jesus. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through town. A man there named Zacchaeus, a ruler of tax collectors, was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but being a short man, he couldn't because of the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed up a sycamore tree so he could see Jesus, who was about to pass that way. When Jesus came to that spot, he looked up and said, "Zacchaeus, come down here at once. I must stay in your home today." So Zacchaeus came down at once, happy to welcome Jesus. Everyone who saw this grumbled, saying, "He has gone to be the guest of a sinner." Zacchaeus stopped and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, I give half my possessions to the poor. And if I've cheated anyone, I repay them four times as much." Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this household because he too is a son of Abraham. The human one came to seek and save the lost." May this become God's word for us. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. It is good to be here and worship with you all. I'm just feeling so nourished by the music ministry here. So thank you for filling my spirit today, this morning, as I'm with you. My name is Katarina Haya. Thank you for pronouncing it right, although it's a hard one. My maiden name was Friesen and got married last year. So some may know me as Katarina Friesen. I come from Russian Mennonite families. Let me see if this slide works here. Oh, other direction. I come from Russian Mennonite families on both sides who settled nearby here in Reedley, California. How many of you are maybe from Reedley or have lived there? Connie, some others, some familiar faces, some new faces. One side came mostly in the late 1800s from Kansas, Nebraska, and Oklahoma, where winters were tough. And I heard that my great-great-grandmother, I believe, said that she came to California because she dreamed of never cooking again. She dreamed of trees where you could just go outside and just pick the food right off, and she wouldn't have to work away in that hot kitchen all the time. They pictured California like a paradise, a promised land where fruit grew thick and the harvest was plentiful, as shown in the cornucopia images here. California, cornucopia of the world, room for millions of immigrants, as this advertising poster said, government lands available. Another side of my family, pictured down in the left corner here, my grandmother's parents escaped across a frozen river of ice from Stalinist Russia to China, and then came to California via Angel Island during the late 1920s. They struggled as recent immigrants and refugees, starting out as migrant farm workers, picking figs and grapes up and down this valley during the Great Depression. Both sides eventually became relatively comfortable, middle-class citizens who bought farmland and houses and who passed on wealth over several generations. They also passed on their faith and their stories and songs to me, and I'm so grateful for their courage in tough times, for their love, for their emphasis on serving others that has so shaped me today. Though they shared a lot of stories and history of our people, of Mennonite, especially from the side that I came on, the Mennonite Brethren tradition, they didn't pass on any stories of who was here before they settled in this place. So I was largely ignorant of that growing up. They probably didn't know that this promised land was already inhabited for over 13,000 years at least by hundreds of thousands of indigenous peoples speaking at least 80 different languages. There's a map up here featuring some of those different groups. My ancestors who arrived in the late 1800s came at the tail end of a literal genocide sponsored by the state of California that paid white settlers over $1 million to kill between 10 to 20,000 Native peoples during and after the Gold Rush period. I didn't realize that the land that my great-grandparents farmed, the land where I live now, including the land where we're meeting on, would have been a massive Native American reservation if the treaties of 1851 and 1852 promising reservation lands to tribes in California had actually been ratified in Congress. It went all the way to Congress and then it was stored under a, locked away under a secrecy agreement until the early 1900s. And during the adult ed hour, I can share a little bit more about some of that history. I hadn't heard about the roots of all of this violence in the doctrine of discovery until about 10 years ago when I interned at the First Mennonite Church of San Francisco. And that summer, the Coalition to Dismantle the Doctrine of Discovery was launched as people convened there. We're a coalition that started among Anabaptists, really responding to indigenous calls to justice and to life. The doctrine of discovery can be traced back to the intertwining of the church and state in the 15th and 16th centuries when European Christian rulers discovered, or as some indigenous people were discovered by indigenous peoples on their lands, and claimed indigenous territories in the New World for their God and King. The doctrine of discovery refers to the legal framework of ownership and domination over that land, and the ways that that framework continues to take, allow, and justify the taking of lands and lives of indigenous peoples around the world. From tribes protecting the Amazon rainforest from deforestation in Brazil, to Apache people in Arizona, whose sacred land right now is being threatened to be transferred by the US government to a copper mining company. This land is known as Oak Flat. Some of you may have heard of this. Our coalition has been accompanying these people. My friend Charlie Carpenter, who's a local Western Mono pastor from Aubrey, told me once that he feels like his experience here of being indigenous is like being exiled in your own homelands. Exiled in your own lands. In Jesus's time, the Jewish people were also living as exiles in their own lands under the thumb of Roman rule. The Roman imperial economic system extracted the resources from the land for massive Roman building projects and imposed heavy taxes on the colonized. Some scholars estimate that the tax rate was as high as 40% of people's income, a burden that left many poor peasants, poor people, struggling to survive. Like many colonial powers, the Romans created internal divisions among the colonized people. In Jesus's day, they divided the Jewish people against one another by giving a privileged minority power and access to wealth. Zacchaeus, or Zacchaeus, as it was pronounced today, played a part in this colonizing system as a chief tax collector among his own Jewish community, which is probably why his own people hated him so much. He likely charged additional fees from the poor in order to enrich himself. In other words, he was skimming off the top. In the story we heard today, Zacchaeus is short, and so he climbs up a sycamore tree to look down over the crowd gathering around Jesus in Jericho, and Jesus looked up at him, as it says in verse 5. Did anyone here ever grow up singing that children's song? Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and wee little man was he. I'm seeing some nods. He climbed up in the sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. He sees Jesus from up in the sycamore tree, as the ditty says. And Jesus sees Zacchaeus. I love this little note here that Jesus sees Zacchaeus, and it reminds me of Jesus's encounter with the rich young ruler in Mark 10, where Jesus looks at him and loves him. Looks at him and loves him. Jesus immediately invites himself over for dinner at Zacchaeus's home, much to the dismay of the grumbling crowd who labels Zacchaeus a sinner. And Zacchaeus climbs down the tree. His encounter with Jesus is life-changing and results in a change of heart, a total repentance related to his economic practices. When he welcomes Jesus into his home, Zacchaeus pledges to publicly to redistribute his wealth. "Half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much." This wee little man acknowledges the enormous injustice of his actions, repents, and releases what is not his to own back to the community with 400% restitution, not a wee little sum. What surprised me after studying this passage was that Zacchaeus's actions of reparative justice are connected to his salvation, as Jesus says. After he commits to redistribution and reparation, Jesus proclaims in verse 9, "Today salvation has come to this house." And that word in salvation in Greek has so many rich layers of meaning. It could be understood to connote healing, deliverance, freedom, provision. Today healing has come to this house. Or today deliverance and freedom has come to this house. That has a different sound to it than the one narrow understanding of what it meant for a soul to be saved that I grew up with in the Christian church. With his salvation, with his healing and deliverance, Jesus affirms Zacchaeus's restoration to the community as a child of Abraham, a child of God. The divide and conquer tactics are subverted, and another child of the Creator is converted, or you could say is decolonized, and brought home back into Jesus's beloved community. When Jesus comes down, or when Zacchaeus comes down from his high place up in the tree and up on the social ladder, he is restored. This movement down echoes the exultant vision of Jesus's mother Mary in the Magnificat when she proclaims that through Creator's liberation, the powerful has been brought down and the poor have been lifted up in Luke 1. Zacchaeus's redistributive justice is a continuation of the Jubilee vision from the Hebrew scriptures that Jesus carried out in his ministry, restoring people to our common humanity, bringing down the powerful to share table fellowship with the lowly, thus creating right relations. For those of us who have benefited from the colonization of these lands, especially those of us who are from European descent in the church, I wonder, what can we learn from Jesus's invitation to Zacchaeus to come down and be restored to right relation? I offer four movements from this story as we consider how the Zacchaeus story might apply to our work as Christian faith communities seeking the way of repair at the invitation of Jesus. The first one is remembering, and I've illustrated a kind of circle here from restorative justice models that I've seen or that other colleagues have contributed to. So remembering is how I label the sort of first movement of this reparative justice. Through Jesus's invitation, Zacchaeus remembers on multiple levels. He remembers the ways that he's harmed people. He remembers also that who he is, a child of Abraham, a child of God. And through his actions, Zacchaeus himself is remembered to the community, returned. His encounter with Jesus leads to deeper belonging and a deeper sense of identity than the status, dishonest wealth, and privilege offered to him by Rome. And the next movement, repenting, these kind of flow together. In a radical extension of grace, Jesus asks Zacchaeus to come down from his position of power to welcome him. Zacchaeus responds with truth-telling about how he has benefited from defrauding others and commits to redistribute wealth as a tangible step of repentance. How can those of us who are in positions of power or born into privilege or as church communities come down in a spirit of repentance and humility? And the next sort of part of this spiral is repairing. Zacchaeus commits to direct repair for the harms he committed. Jesus proclaims this process as saving Zacchaeus. The process of repair isn't just an apology, it involves making amends for the harms done, seeking to make things as right as possible, as restorative justice practitioners say. How can we, as a wider church body, the body of Christ, participate in actions of repair that move beyond repudiations or apologies for the harms of colonization and towards relationship and towards addressing the underlying systems of violence? And then I've added this fourth part of the spiral, reimagining. We don't know what happens next to Zacchaeus or to the community in Jericho, but I wonder how this story of reparative justice may have had some ripple effects, may have disrupted the Roman structure of domination in some way, small or large. Did it challenge the status quo and lead to further right relations among oppressed and oppressors? We don't know, but the story can spark our imaginations towards courageous, creative action for the sake of a more just and beautiful world today. How might our reparative actions lead us to reimagine, to contribute to these ripple effects for wider healing? And at the center of this circle, we see that restoration to community, to harmony, to shalom, being really the core of these movements of reparative justice, of repair. Before I close, I want to offer a few stories to spark our imagination of people who are living out the Zacchaeus story, I think, and the communities with them who are in relationship. There are more inspiring examples, and I can share more in the adult ed hour. I brought a resource to recommend called Stories of Repair that our coalition edited. The first one is this guy, John Stace, who I really have enjoyed getting to know. He's the former director of MCC Central States. Some of you are nodding or maybe know him. Mennonite Central Committee Central States, for those of you unfamiliar with MCC. And John Stace said to me that he identified with the Zacchaeus story. He said, I saw myself in Zacchaeus when he learned about the theft of Dakota homelands where he lived and where his family farm was, and the removal of Dakota peoples, indigenous peoples there by the US government. He had a heart change and was convicted. He had inherited some family farmland or money from the sale of family farmland that was once part of these Dakota territories in present-day Minnesota that had been taken from the Dakota people. And so when he received the funds, he released half in the spirit of Zacchaeus to an indigenous-led Dakota land recovery organization called Makoche Ikichupi, working to restore their language, culture, and foodways, all tied to the land. If they didn't have land, they couldn't have language. They couldn't have traditional foods. They couldn't have the culture that was so tied and connected with land. And then after that, in relationship with Makoche, John biked across Minnesota on his recumbent bicycle because he told me, I just love triking. It was his passion, it was his hobby. So he triked all over Minnesota on this recumbent bike, speaking at churches, speaking to newspapers, raising awareness and raising funds for Dakota land return, saying it's unrealistic to return all of the land to Dakota peoples, but it is unjust to return none. And that really impacted me. The next story I want to share is from Seattle Mennonite Church. Seattle Mennonite contributes to regular restitution fund to Real Rent, a Seattle area voluntary rent collection fund that benefits the Duwamish tribe on whose lands the church lives and worships. This is one way of recognizing that the tribe was never compensated for their land, resources, and livelihood. And these kinds of settler land taxes or rent arrangements are creative ways of offering some form of back rent or tax or compensation for those who have been defrauded by broken treaties and stolen lands. Another example, I want to highlight that the work of repair will take more than individual actions or even just individual church actions or restitution funds, like I've shared. Ultimately, it's going to take a movement that transforms the structures of violence that continue to dispossess the most vulnerable around the world. This is happening still today. The ongoing doctrine of discovery impacts. It's going to take people of privilege from dominant culture standing alongside those who are oppressed. And my hope is that the church will step up into this work of active repentance. One recent example, Indigenous organizations recently invited those of us in our coalition to act in support of the Indian Child Welfare Act, or ICWA. Raise your hand if you've heard of ICWA before. So several of you. This was legislation passed in the 1970s to address the rates at which Indigenous children were being taken from their tribes and placed mostly in white foster and adoptive settings. It was a continuation of the assimilation policies of the boarding school era, when Native American children were taken from their home cultures and communities to be civilized, often in church-run boarding schools, with the express policy to kill the Indian to save the man. ICWA is currently being challenged in the Supreme Court, pictured at the right, and so we've been showing up in actions through vigils, educating churches, praying, learning together, and inviting people to join our repair network, a broader network that I'll be sharing more about during the sermon talk back time. And I know Willow Avenue is considering joining. It would be wonderful to have you join us in this network, which originated in Mennonite Church USA and is quickly growing. We have the opportunity today, to seek the way of salvation and healing, the way toward right relations that Jesus offers us. Indigenous peoples have experienced so much trauma, and yet they're still alive today. The land still remembers and bears the wounds of ongoing colonization, and yet there's still the opportunity to seek restoration. Jesus, the one who is both our guest and our host, invites us to remember, to repent, to repair, and to reimagine what could the future hold if we move towards justice, decolonization, and life today. As Sarah Augustine writes in her book, Sarah Augustine is the co-founder of our coalition and my colleague, an Indigenous Mennonite woman, she writes, engaging in repair will mean turning away from this violence of the doctrine of discovery by risking our own security to challenge the powers that threaten us all. The legacy we leave to our descendants will be life. May it be so.
A very warm welcome to guests and visitors who have joined us this morning. We're so glad that you are here. We invite you to join us for refreshments across the courtyard in the fellowship hall immediately following the service. Our second hour starts at 11, and so if you're on Facebook Live and you want to be a part of this conversation with Katarina, we invite you to jump over to Zoom to participate in that conversation. If you're in person, that will be happening in the conference room. Youth and friendship classes will be in their rooms as usual for a second hour, and kids get to have Service Sunday with Margie Stewart. One of the ways that our congregation shares in our life together is with our time and service. In the Wednesday email, as well as the Saturday email under announcements, you'll find links to sign up to help with preparing the communion elements, scripture reading, and refreshments during fellowship time that we enjoy. Thank you today to Peggy Davis, Lynn and Donna Jost for preparing and serving refreshments this morning. And we also offer, share our gifts of financial support, and we're grateful for every gift, big and small, online, through your bank, and in person. There is a box in the back near the middle door for those gifts that you may have with you physically this morning. And so now we invite you to stand in body or spirit for our final song, Renew Your Church, Voices Together, 717. Receive now this benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all and give us peace. Amen, and go in peace.